Ohio County Chamber of Commerce. We're so excited to see this building opening up to the public. It's nice to see such a large crowd in Rosine, and we can't wait to see what this is going to do for our county. I'll pass it on to the judge if he'd like to say anything.
Like I said, we've been waiting for this day a long time.
Yes, sir.
I believe James said he was, when he was at the ground breaking, he said that was the third one he'd been to. So this is different in that there's actually a building here. We got one going. So I'm really proud. We've been waiting for many years for this day, and it's a proud day for Ohio County.
Yes.
I'm glad to be here today. I agree with the judge. It's been a long time coming to this. My father would be proud of this. He'd be happy that you finally got this going, you know. So we're just thankful for this. We thank you a lot.
Nope, I'm just really excited. After we cut this ribbon, we'll go inside for some more of the ceremony.
Lastly, Mr. Embry, you have anything you'd like to say?
I'm very proud of this facility, and so glad it's come to fruition, and proud to be here for this event.
All right.
Let's cut it.
Let's go fast.
We're glad everybody's here today, and like I said outside, we've been waiting for this day for a really long time. I'm going to take care of two or three little things on the program to begin with, including welcoming all of you here, which we did. We're really proud to have each and every one of you here. Too many to name, but we're glad for every one of you that's here. Right now, I'm going to get a couple things done. I'm going to ask a friend of mine, Father Fidelis Leverie, to come forward and lead us in a prayer. Here he is. Come up here and do that, and then next will be CB.
I was pastor at Holy Redeemer Church here in Ohio County for the 7 years, a friend of our judge here for the same number of years, active in the Right to Life movement. So I'm very familiar with this area. So let's pray, ask God's blessing on all of this project, as beautiful as it is. God our Father, we thank you for this museum, Bluegrass Museum of Bill Monroe. We are proud, Lord, that you have helped us to build this institution, not only here now, but for the future as well. And for the music that is a gift from God, help us to know that music can bind us together, to know the beauty of God, the beauty of what music is all about. Help us, Lord, to be grateful and to proclaim your love to all persons that we meet. And we pray in the beloved name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you very much. Next, I want to ask our state senator, Senator C.B. Embry, to come up. When C.B. was judge executive, and I'm hoping James remembers this as well, in 1983, we had our first Bill Monroe Bluegrass Festival at the Ohio County Park. And being so proud that Bill was here, we presented him with a plaque. And the picture of C.B. giving that plaque is over on that wall behind the car. And C.B.'s going to read it to you and tell you a little bit about it from 1983, and then he will go over and hang it on the wall. And this plaque came back to us as the Bill Monroe memorabilia. That's why we have it again. I presented this to Bill. Thanks for bringing bluegrass music home for all your friends to enjoy. With love and gratitude from all over Ohio County. I might also mention that I had the privilege of driving Bill to Frankfort when Governor Wallace Wilkerson signed the bill naming Blue Moon of Kentucky the official state bluegrass song. And Bill was there with me and the governor. And after the governor signed the bill, Bill sung Blue Moon of Kentucky, and he did a little dance with it too. And boy, all the secretaries around there really had a big kick out of that. So I was honored to do that. So now you want me to
hang it up over there.
Here we go.
And now for a while, we're going to turn this over to the Tourism Commission. Jody, here she comes.
Thank you, Judge. I just want to thank everybody for being here. Tourism has the contract to go to handle the museum, and it has been an honor and a privilege to be working with that agreement. When I moved here so many years ago, I just wasn't sure about the bluegrass and everything, and I just watched what happened throughout the years. And this last year working on the museum, I've just come to know so many wonderful people and things, and it's just been great. Tourism is our second biggest industry in Kentucky, and I hope that gets up. Oh, really? Because I think that surprises people. They don't actually realize what tourism does for the state of Kentucky. And here in Ohio County, we have many things, and the amphitheater is doing its part, bringing in folks to come for concerts. For instance, the John Prine concert is sold out. But it still is bluegrass that puts Ohio County on the map and why people still come here. Last year, the home place had over 1,300 visitors, and that included people from Japan, the UK, Canada, France, Sweden. So I want you to know that people come here because of Bill. There was a period of time when I first began this job when they were asking me about the sign out in front, and I hesitated because, you know, for so many years it was, the sign said Jerusalem Ridge. And the volunteers are telling me, but people get confused. They think that is the site for the festival. So, but my marketing mind, I just couldn't think of all those years that had been marketed that way to change it. And so I was really struggling with it. Well, I did go to a marketing class and to a branding class, and I asked the promoter and the speaker at that time, I said, let me ask you a question. And he was familiar. He had been raised in Bowling Green, so he knew the whole situation. And he said, well, let me just ask you this. Would you have Jerusalem Ridge without Bill Monroe? And I said, no. But would you have Bill Monroe without Jerusalem Ridge? And the answer is yes. So it's Bill that made Jerusalem Ridge and made everything famous. So we did change the sign out in front. It says Bill Monroe Home Place now. And when people go to their phone, they hit the B and it comes up Bill Monroe Home Place. Now they're going to be seeing the Bill Monroe Museum. So I'm really excited about that. This is the soft opening. We'll be doing a grand opening because as you look around, you can see we're still a work in progress. Lots has been done since we had the dinner and the fundraiser here, but there's still more to do. We're gonna keep working. Some of these displays are temporary and things will keep happening all the time. So we want to invite you to come back often, bring your friends and come back often. And at one time or other, if you've ever heard me speak, you've heard me say that it's a bluegrass family. Well, never was it so true than this last week. I took a little 3-day kidney stone vacation in the hospital this week, and it was bluegrass family that pulled it together. I know I text Chase out of the blue and just said, will you take that TV up there for me? And I'm sure when he read it, he was like, what? Yes, nobody knew. I just started giving orders from the bed, from my phone. The judge came in, picked up a 2.5-page list of things to do, and people just all came together. And I'm not going to mention everybody individually because I don't want to miss anybody, but they all came up together and really helped pull this off and get it open. So it is a bluegrass family. All of you that are here know that it's a bluegrass family, and we're just so happy that you're here. So, but the bottom line is, it's a county building, and tourism manages it, but it's your museum. And it's gonna, I believe, we're gonna change a lot with Ohio County with the museum. So, thank you very much, and I would like to call on James to come up and just say a few words for us.
Well, I appreciate that. You talk pretty good today. It's good to see all of you all out here today. Good to see a guy, it's a Bluegrass Boy, all of myself. When I started out with my father, he brought me up here. Let me get back to my original thing. My dad brought me up here when I was like 3 or 4 years old. He and Mom was going to go fox hunting. And he'd build a big fire up on Jerusalem Ridge. And I had a little sleeping bag he brought me. And I'd stay in that, everybody would be gone when I woke up, I'd be scared. Because I could hear them talking way on down the road, you know. But that's one of the stories I remember, guy, from years back. But this thing is wonderful, and I can't imagine what all they're going to do to it. Good to see Daddy's Cadillac there. Give Jody a hand, would you? I think she deserves all of this. And it's just so many faces I've seen up here for many years, and I'm just proud to be here today with you. Thank you, folks, very much.
And Guy, would you like to come forward and say a few words for us? Could you come up and say a few words for us? Guy Stevenson's here with us. Stevenson is here with us, and Guy was one of Bill's bluegrass players. He was a bluegrass boy.
Well, I tell you, when I first went to work for Bill, I'd heard that he was hard to get along with, and he was cranky and all this kind of stuff. So I was half scared to death when I went to work for him. Well, come to find out, if you went on stage with him and had your instrument in good tune, and didn't hit any bad notes, stayed in time, it tickled him to death, didn't it? Yeah, that's what he was all about, was his music. And, you stop to think about it. Here's a man with a sixth grade education, created music that is known around the world. That's quite an accomplishment. Man with a sixth grade education. And I asked him one time, when you first started doing this, did you ever realize or you were thinking your music would get this big? He said, I had no idea. The only thing I knew is I liked to play it. And play it he did. I worked for him for about a year, and I was working for State of Missouri is where I was an auditor in the Motor Fuel Tax Division. And I had a lot of comp time coming because I never take a vacation or sick leave or anything else. We got so much a month. And it finally got down to where I was going to have to take it or I was going to lose it. And so I took off and played for Bill for a year. And I got a check for my job every month. So that's kind of hard to beat. I got paid twice, you know, for working for me. No, it was mine. I had it coming. If I hadn't the gutter, they'd have cheated me. But anyhow, I enjoyed. There was about a year that I played for Bill, and I enjoyed every show that we did. I enjoyed every trip, and I was older than the other guys. Some of them were teen coming. Well, I know Jack Hicks, he was maybe 17 or 18 year old. So I wasn't an old man, but I was like closer to Bill than any of the rest of the guys in the group. So, and I was raised in the same background he was, over in the Ozarks in Missouri. Rocky Hillside Farm, and we farmed in the summertime, cut clothes and mining crops and so on in the wintertime. So we had the same upbringing, the same background. And so we had a lot of conversations when we were traveling. And I know I asked him one time, I said, Bill, do you like sorry blazes? He said, no, sir. I said, why? He said, I can remember this the time when that's all we had to eat. He said, I got enough of them. So he was, anything he had to say, it was quick and direct to the point. And there was, and that's the way it was, and no changing it. And, but I tell you what, I really enjoyed the time that I played for him. I wish I could have stayed longer, but I really did enjoy every minute that I worked with him. He was kind of peculiar. I watched him like a hawk, because and it finally got to him. I knew when you could talk to him and when you couldn't. If you saw him standing somewhere staring off out of space, don't bother him. You try to talk to him, he just turned around and walked off. Never say a word. Well, it wasn't long. The guys who wanted to talk to him, they noticed that any time I went up there, I could talk to him. It wasn't long, the guys come to me and say, hey, you can talk to Bill. Would you ask him this? You ask him that. I said, hey, if you'll just wait, I'll tell you when you can go talk to him yourself. Can you? I said, well, yeah. And so that was quite an experience, was to watch him, because he was different than any person I'd ever met. And one of the greatest friends I ever had. And I tell you what, I still love him today as much as I ever did when I was working for him. I know, as far as I know, we never had a crossword. I was listening. He was talking about my father. I've seen him talking sometimes, you know, and that's the truth. He had his mind on music sometimes too, when you thought he was not being too nice to you or something. But he was always coming up with melodies, and he would try to remember those, and he did remember them. But I was thinking about, he told me when he was living here with his uncle Ben, he would haul cross ties from here to Beaver Dam, and that was an all day job, man, with a team of horses. And that's kind of hard work he did when he lived here in Ohio County. But my grandfather worked timber, worked coal, and all the Monroes did that. But I just got to think about some of the stories when he was talking about him. While he was quiet sometimes, he was thinking about his music most of the time. Or something important he had to do, you know. But he loved this country. He's the man who promoted this town, Rosine, Kentucky. The world would never heard of this town had been for Bill Monroe. Every time I'm talking, on the Opry, most of the times he would mention that he was from Rosine, Kentucky, proud of this country. Wrote Blue Moon, Kentucky about when he was up here. He saw the blue moon one time, that's what he wrote the song about. But he loved this place, he would be proud of this. Be proud of you all for being here today. Thank you.
What I think will happen now that we have had the soft opening and people come to visit is what happened today. I don't see him right now, but there's a gentleman out there that came from Evansville, Indiana today. He donated this shirt that we have hanging on the stage, and he also made a donation today. Where are you? I can't see you. But thank you very much, and that's what we hope continues to happen as you're finding me. There you are. Thank you. So, yes. James carried this in and brought this to us today. And this is what we hope to replicate with the statue of Bill. You may have noticed the bricks in the front there. Well, if you purchased a brick, it's in that pile. The next shipment went out and it'll be in the next order. As soon as our weather breaks and we can make a lawn out there, we'll be starting to make the Blue Moon walkway leading out to a statue. And we're going to replicate this as much as we can to have this, because this is what Bill wanted his statue to be. I would like to call all our mandolin players up, and Josh. We are going to, and Josh, we're going to have what it's all about, a little bluegrass music. The mandolin players will come forward and they're going to play Soldier's Joy.
Check. Wayne asked me if I had something to say, and I think anybody who follows this style of mandolin player playing has probably got something to say about it. One thing is, it's the greatest way to play. I think if you stuck somebody on an island and gave them a mandolin with no knowledge, I think they would play like Bill Monroe. It's just natural. And mandolin players who follow this style take it serious. The style, I was told, is it has no pretense. And that's the beautiful thing about Bill Monroe's music. It has no pretense. It's straightforward, and it connects with common people. And that's what made it so great. So I think we're going to do an old Bill favorite called Soldier's Joy. And I think that Dwayne will introduce it.
For those of you who don't know, these three mandolins belong to the museum. You gonna let yours go in too?
Yeah, don't make it, man.
You don't need me. Okay. And you'll see the guitar sitting over here was what Charlie played. I don't know if it's going to be played on the road or not. But these mandolins, some of them, especially this one right here, is a little bit structurally misshapen, you might say, wouldn't you, Mark? But I tuned it up and I'm going to try to get through this tune. You might say, well, why didn't you play a Bill Monroe tune? Well, everybody around here has heard a lot of Bill Monroe tunes, and I'm sure Bill probably played this tune right here through the years, probably as much as he played a lot of his own tunes. Good old square dancing song, and you boys, put this up. But anyhow, welcome to the Bill Monroe Museum. We're glad you guys are here, and things are still going along, and they're going to keep making improvements, and I'm sure that different exhibits will be offered up and will be collected by the museum over the years, and this has been a long time coming. I remember in 1975, I think it was, or four, he remembers it, I don't know if Mark does or not, there was a Bill Monroe Bluegrass Festival right here on this spot. I was a junior in high school. My dad did all the electrician work. The stage was an old semi-trailer. And I bet Bill never in his wildest dreams ever expected there would be a museum in his honor standing here on that site. One of the only festivals he ever did in Rosine. I think it might be the only one. He did one down at Horton?
Down
at Wells' Stretch down there. Anyway, that's enough of me. Everybody ready? Come on, Mark. I want to get warmed up.